Welcome to the Global from Asia podcast, where the daunting process of running an international business from Hong Kong is broken down into straight up actionable advice. And now, your host, Michael Michelini.
Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to another episode of Global from Asia, number 49. It's been 1 year almost, coming up soon, and I'm really excited recording this introduction after an amazing mastermind call a couple days ago. We had six really awesome business people from very different backgrounds got together. I know it was a first time for all of us to do this kind of a mastermind, and I had to kind of explain a little bit. We used Google Hangouts, got to introduce each other and our business goals, and we had a lot of different people from both Asia and Europe. We helped Gerard on the hot seat. He was in the Netherlands. He still doesn't have a Hong Kong business open. He's still not sure if it's worth it and the actual costs. He's doing sourcing between Europe and China with betafresh.com. And he got a lot of information trying to figure out. He got a 5,000 euro quote to open a Hong Kong company from the Netherlands. Much cheaper to do inside Hong Kong. We have people on the show we've interviewed that can also help him out. So he's really, really happy, and it was a lot of fun. And we're going to have the call in a couple more weeks. Okay, and also I'm pretty exhausted. I am actually haven't had dinner yet. I got back directly from Hong Kong, was there doing client meetings, met some listeners, one being Angela from APV, Asia Pacific Vision Limited, which does video recording. We took a picture together. I'm going to put it in the show notes. It was a lot of fun. Met her in a coffee shop in Wan Chai. She's reached out to me with the following, and then I connected to her. I've been listening for a while. I can't remember how I stumbled upon your podcast. I tried to leave you an iTunes review based in Hong Kong with iTunes Hong Kong account, but it's not working. Not sure why. Anyway, here's a review. Feel free to share it. Title, highly recommend detailed, high-quality advice. I'm based in Hong Kong and manage a small business, even though I'm not involved in import-export, but still find this podcast thoroughly helpful. I can't remember how I stumbled upon it, but finding myself listening to a batch of episodes at a time. As the podcast host Michael says, it's straight up actionable advice for anyone wanting to run an international business via Hong Kong / China. He selects appropriate experts, asks detailed questions, summarizes where helpful, and keeps it flowing smoothly, concisely, and in a relaxed, easygoing way. Well worth a listen if you're involved in sourcing, manufacturing, Kickstarter, etc., or doing any business between Asia and the rest of the world. All right. Thanks so much, Angela. I really, really appreciate it. And hopefully we can get that onto the iTunes reviews. I still only have a few. So everyone really, really helps. I think it affects ratings so I can get more downloads or something. But anyway, onto the show. We have a fun topic here. It's going into the U.S., U.S. of A. And I dialed in to two amazing people working in the U.S. government. We know that there's been trends of people buying from overseas into China and importing, whereas the previous trends have been exporting from the Chinese factories. There's a lot of consumption now buying American goods, European goods, and other parts of the West. So it's got these two American government gurus, Bryson and Paul, who help dealing with U.S. export businesses selling American goods abroad. I've learned a lot from this. I was taking lots of notes, which I'll share below. And you can always check them out at globalfromasia.com/episode49. And without further ado, let's get into the interview. All right. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in to another Global from Asia podcast. We have on a line with us Bryson Patterson from the Export Finance Specialist at the U.S. Small Business Administration, and Paul Bergman from the U.S. Department of Commerce. And we're going to talk about export programs for American companies. So thank you so much for being on the show, guys.
Michael, thanks for hosting us today.
Yeah, good morning, Michael.
Yeah, good morning. So could maybe you guys a little bit more about yourselves?
Sure. As you said, I'm an export finance specialist with the U.S. Small Business Administration. SBA, as the title indicates, is the Small Business Administration. We've got a number of different programs. We call them the three C's, D and an E, but we provide counseling to small businesses to help them get started. We help them get contracts with the federal government through a program called 8A. We also provide capital. That's probably what we're most well known for, and that's what I'm going to be speaking about mostly today. That's as it indicates in my title, my main focus is export finance issue. We also provide disaster assistance. So, many of your listeners might be familiar with Hurricane Katrina. after Hurricane Katrina, SBA provided direct loans to businesses and even the homeowners to help them rebuild their businesses and their homes. And the E is export assistance. And so, you know, that's sort of where I straddle both the E and the E for export and C for capital. And I provide counseling and assistance to small businesses who are exporting. And SBA does that through loan guarantee programs. I guess I've been with the agency about 6 years, and I got a master's degree from University of San Diego. I shouldn't say University of San Diego, I should say University of California, San Diego, because the University of San Diego is a different school that I didn't go to. Okay, so anyway, that's me. That's SBA in a nutshell. Paul?
Good morning, Michael, again. I am the director for the United States Department of Commerce, International Trade Administration for Colorado and Wyoming. So my job, along with the six trade specialists I have, is to help companies sell their products and services around the world from Colorado and Wyoming. Our services provide marketing information, research, help the company find an agent, a distributor, help them to do a credit check. We can do trade shows, work with them to get to trade shows overseas, and also counseling. And I've been doing this now for 40 years, traveled, worked, and visited in over 30 different countries. Took the first trade mission from Colorado back 29 years ago to Beijing, Shanghai, and Hunan. And it was the first trade mission from Colorado with the lieutenant governor going over there. And I know the exact year because my twin daughters were born about 2 weeks before I left on the trade mission going to China. And my academic background, graduated from a small Jesuit school here in Denver from Regis College. And then I have my master's from Thunderbird down in Phoenix. And as I said, been here in Denver since 81 when I was coming in from Romania as a commercial attaché and came into Denver then. So that's a quick, short history about where I'm coming from today.
And Michael, I should say, you know, it's taking even a step back, when you think about export assistance for U.S. companies, I'd say, you know, in the big scheme of things, there's probably about 20 federal agencies that have something to do with exporting, you know, from license requirements that are issued by the Department of State, you know, all the way to the Department of Agriculture. But I'd say there's probably five key agencies. Of course, Commerce is the lead agency, SBA, Ex-Im Bank, and probably Department of Agriculture are the big ones. And so Paul's the director of the U.S. Export Assistance here in Denver, U.S. Export Assistance Center in Denver. And it's a collaborative multi-agency office. And I'll let Paul explain a little bit about how that came about.
Yeah, it goes back to Secretary Ron Brown, and he wanted to come up with an idea to help the companies in a one-stop shop. So we put together Department of Commerce, the SBA, the Governor's Office for International Trade here in Denver, and also the World Trade Center. And we were all located in one office suite and became a one-stop shop so a company could come in and see the feds, the state, and the World Trade Center, all working together to help that company sell the product or services around the world. For 27 years, we were located there. We also added the British Trade Commissioner and the Canadian Counselor. So it really became the hub of the international community here in Denver. But due to different circumstances, and so the Commerce Department and the SBA has moved to another building. But we still all work very, very closely. And that is one of the unique things about Colorado, the close relationship that we have with SBA, the Governor's Office, the World Trade Center, the British, the Canadians, we all work together to help sell Colorado products around the world.
Mm-hmm. And there's a number of U.S. Export Assistance Centers throughout the country, and there are always a collaboration of SBA, the Department of Commerce, and the Ex-Im Bank.
We have about 101 offices throughout the United States, and then my counterparts in about 90 different countries. So we're at the U.S. Embassy, but we have Department of Commerce, Foreign Commercial Service people in the embassies. And in China, we have people in Beijing, Chengdu, Guangzhou, Shanghai, Shenyang, and Wuhan. And then, of course, also in Hong Kong and at the American Institute in Taipei.
That's really great. a lot of listeners have been asking for a show like this, and I really appreciate you both coming on. And that sounds really great that it's all together in Denver. And I think it's hard for any – governments are just so big. You know, I think it's overwhelming a lot of times for small businesses sometimes to just know who to talk to or which department to talk to. And I think by keeping it together or the communication flowing quickly between all of them really helps a lot in that. So what do you think is the first step, maybe if somebody's thinking to try to export something from America?
Well, if they're here in the United States, it would be contact the local USIAC and to talk to them about getting involved and where they want to go, what's the product, help them find a market, or do they have an idea where to go. So contacting the local USIAC, as I said, we had about 100 and some offices, almost one in every state. So that would be the first step. We can then talk to them if they're looking for an agent distributor, what their product, are they really, should they be looking at that market, and hold their hands. We work with our partners by different seminars, how to get involved in exporting. If the person is over, we'll say in China, they should go into the commercial service at the embassy or consulate and talk to one of the commercial officers about bringing in American products into China, and they would be able to help them and try to find leads here in the United States for those types of products if they need that.
And I'd like to add a step zero. I mean, if you're a person and you don't have, maybe you're not exporting yet, I mean, you're really just brand new to exporting from the United States, SBA has an export business planner that we host on our website. Our website is probably the second most important website for exporters. I'd say the most important website for exporters is export.gov, which is hosted by the Department of Commerce, which is a fabulous resource for market and industry reports, a great way to connect with your local export assistance center or commercial officers overseas. But the second most important website, SBA.gov, and if you go SBA.gov/export-business-planner, you can get a downloadable PDF that you can literally create your export business plan. So just like when you start a business, you need a business plan. When you export, you need to have a plan. And it's about 30 pages or something like that. But it asks you a lot of questions like, you know, what makes your product successful in the United States? And, you know, not all of them are applicable to everybody, but it helps you walk through that process, thinking about your business strategically. And then it's also full of links to other resources. So when you get to the place where you need to determine what your HS code is, you know, there's links to websites that help you figure that out.
That's really great. Well, I'm writing it down.
and Michael, as Bryson said about export.gov, we also have one for the Americans in China that would put them in contact with the embassy. It's http://www.buybuyusa.gov/China/E=Eagle-N=Nancy. buyusa.gov/China/EN. And so that'll put them into the commercial service at the embassy in Beijing or Chengdu or Guangzhou, wherever, to list the officers and the services that are available and also events that are going on, visiting delegations that are coming, trade shows that are happening in there. So it gives the local people somewhere to go contact us directly.
Got it. This is really, really great. So I know there's probably a lot of different programs, but I think sometimes maybe some of the listeners were thinking when they talked to me is what kind of is there any benefits or programs for exporting, maybe financial aid or other kinds of support that the government can help with? Or
depending on where you're located, there's different stuff. So different states have different programs. Here in Colorado, there's a matching grant program. So if a company is looking to expand, it's a Colorado company, they're looking to expand to a new market, they can get as much as $15,000 from the state on a one-to-one basis. You know, if they put in $15,000, they can get an additional $15,000 to attend a trade show, to do some paid market research, to maybe alter their product so it's more localized to the market they're looking for. And there's various programs like that throughout the 50 states. On the federal side, there's no direct grant programs per se, but, you know, at SBA and Ex-Im Bank, we work with businesses to structure their transactions in a way that's financeable, in a way that's safe. You know, I've talked to a lot of people who, you know, they're not safe. They're not using letters of credit or they're not using credit insurance, which can be quite risky, I think. But we work with businesses to set those up. Ex-Im Bank offers a credit insurance program, which is incredibly reasonable, at 65 cents on $100. So, you know, if you had a $100 invoice, then you wanted to get insurance for that in the event that your buyer defaults, can't pay, there's maybe a currency event or a political event that makes it impossible for them to pay, Ex-Im Bank will pay 95% of that invoice amount. So, again, on this $100 invoice, you pay 65 cents. If your buyer cannot pay you, you get $95 back. So that's a good program for exporters. And one of the things that sets up on the U.S. side is the ability to set up a line of credit against foreign receivables. And that's what I work on specifically for the Small Business Administration. The Export-Import Bank of the U.S. has a similar program. And I should say the main difference between SBA and the Export-Import Bank is size. SBA's maximum loan is $5 million, which used to be a whole lot of money, but it's still a good chunk of change. And Ex-Im Bank doesn't have a maximum, so they do very large loans. They did a $250 million loan to the Ford Motor Company. They do enormous loans for Boeing and GE and some of the big companies. So they're able to do that. So, but they also do a lot of, you know, $6 million, $8 million loans for U.S. Manufacturers. So, and I just, one of the things I want to say is one of the benefits of these programs and these loan guarantee programs is that it gives U.S. companies an advantage. You know, a typical small business in the United States can borrow money at, you know, 6%, 5%, is not unheard of. And so you're able, you know, by doing that, you're able to offer a product in a financing package that's really competitive overseas. I don't know what rates are like in China right now, but, you know, I work with different businesses that are selling into Latin America, and many businesses in Latin America are borrowing money, you know, at even, you know, 15, 20% would be pretty common, actually.
Yeah, I don't, well, I mean, as an American here, I don't think I could ever borrow money in China. So, yeah, it's really great. Usually everything here is cash, and I know a lot of importers have to take that big risk by offering terms to buyers in China on credit to stores and retailers. So this is it's definitely a great program. And I just wonder about maybe I'll just break it down just for listeners that might have not followed it. Maybe you can correct me if I say it wrong. So if you have a product, say, you know, like, I guess wine, I always talk about wine. So say there's wine you have in your, maybe let's just keep it simple and say Colorado, since that's what you're familiar with. I don't know if there's a lot of wine in Colorado, but you get a buyer in China for 100,000, let's just say small, maybe 100,000 US, and they want to get it terms. So you'd have to get, you know, unless you paid for that wine up front, you could get financing from the SBA to get the money up front to make the wine and then sell that to your buyer in China, put it on a boat, send it to them, and then they'd pay you back, and then you would pay back the SBA bank, right?
Yep, that's exactly the way it works. The only caveat I'd add is that SBA doesn't do any direct lending, except for disasters. So we work through banks. And so the one step you're missing there is, yeah, you could borrow the money to produce the wine. You'd borrow it from your local bank. If they see that as a good credit risk, great. You know, they're going to lend you the money just at a conventional loan, and you're going down the road just as you described, producing, shipping, and billing. And, you know, if you've got that Ex-Im Bank credit insurance policy in place, now you can offer your Chinese buyer 60-day terms on that $100,000 wine. So that's a great deal. In the event that I tell people SBA is in butt land. There's always a butt. It's a great vineyard, but it's only been in operation for 6 months. It's a great vineyard, but, you know, they've got some credit issues. The bank may not be comfortable making that loan to this business. an SBA is able to offer to the bank a 90% guarantee. So if, you know, that $100,000, you know, goes off to China and never returns, and the, you know, for whatever reason, the credit insurance policy fails, which is highly unlikely, the bank will come to SBA and say, look, we lost $100,000. SBA will pay the bank $90,000, which is good for the bank. But now the vineyard in Colorado, they still owe that money, and now they owe it to the SBA. But so that's the downside. The plus side, and this is what happens more frequently, is the vineyard that wouldn't have gotten credit otherwise is able to get credit because of that federal guarantee that supports the loan.
Yeah, so this sounds really good. And I'm thinking of a few of my listeners. So one is actually considering moving his manufacturing to the U.S. because the costs have gotten a lot higher inside of China for his manufacturing. I won't disclose him, but it's one specifically. He does LED lighting. So he buys a lot of the components from overseas, you know, like Taiwan or Japan, and he ships it to China, and then he exports it to like the U.S. or to Australia. If he were to move his manufacturing to America, but he bought a lot of his components, say, from Taiwan or Japan, like the chips or the internal parts, but he assembled or made it inside of America. Is that, I mean, what's defined made? And maybe, I don't know if this is too specific a question for the show, but, you know, if he assembled it in America or put a lot of final parts together, or what's made, what's, I guess, the definition of American product?
Michael, we have a special deal for you today. It's a program we've been running. The president started it several years ago, but it's been in the Department of Commerce, but President Obama has really put an emphasis on it. It's called Select USA. And it is where we help American companies or international companies come to relocate or set up manufacturing in the United States. And so if the person's in Chengdu, they should contact our commercial officer, go to that website, and talk to them, or if they're in Beijing or where they're at, and talk to them, tell them that they would like to talk about the Select USA program, and we'll set it up to help them find a site and get the information into the United States. And there are some incentives, not from the U.S. government side, really, but from the states to locate and set up a manufacturing. It's very, very difficult when you're in the high-tech industry to have an all U.S.-made product. It probably doesn't exist. So having different component parts coming in from Taiwan, Hong Kong, China, whatever, but if the majority of it's here in the U.S., it's manufactured, put together here, that's great. We're looking to provide more jobs. So it's Select USA.
One of the points that I'd like, actually, that you brought up in that example I want Paul to touch on is, if you're bringing in components, you could use a free trade zone. And also, maybe we can talk a little bit about the free trade agreements that the United States has with Australia, among other places.
Yeah. What Bryson's referring to is foreign trade zones, and we have several here in Denver. So you could bring those parts in from China into this secure area by U.S. Customs, manufacture, assemble, whatever, to that product, ship it out as a total product, and never have to pay any duty or import fees in bringing that product into the United States. The idea behind it is that we're providing U.S. jobs here. So an example, let's take a bicycle, very simple one. If you brought parts in, the brakes from one country, the tires from another country, the frame from somewhere else, you brought it all here into Denver. And if you brought those individual parts in, it could be 10, 20% per item on the duty rates. But if you brought it into a foreign trade zone, you would not pay any duty rates, and you would be shipping out a complete bicycle duty-free out of the United States. So it's an incentive for, again, U.S. companies, international companies to the United States. And one other one before that, also, if they're bringing that in and they're re-exporting, they may not have a foreign trade zone, but they are eligible for duty drawback. That is that they register that product component when it comes into the United States and state that they plan to re-export that. They will have to pay the duty rate on it at that time, but then they re-export it, show the paperwork, they can get up to 99% of that duty rate when they ship that product out of the United States. So there are several different things. So first thing, contact the commercial service at the embassy or consulate about Select USA or Free Trade Zone. Bryson just mentioned the free trade agreement, and we do not have anything with China now, but we're looking at other ones. I think we have around 24. The biggest one for the United States is the NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, between the United States, Canada, and Mexico. And the idea is to ship products between those three countries duty-free. Now, it's not 100%, but the majority of products going between those countries travel without paying any duties back and forth. And there is a list, and, you know, again, going on to the US.gov, you can get those lists of trading countries we have right now.
And I think if I can add a little bit, I think a lot of times, and I talk to businesses here in the US that they're looking to move sometimes, and one of the things that I point out to them is you need to look at all your costs. You need to look at your utility costs, you know, because sometimes I think businesses really focus on that labor cost, and labor can be a pretty small portion of the actual cost of a lot of goods. But you need to think about, you know, infrastructure, utility costs, the market that you're serving. Is, as Paul pointed out, you know, the United States has free trade agreements with almost every country in our hemisphere except for Brazil, Argentina, Venezuela, and Cuba, I think, are the ones that. But anyway, I won't say anything about that. But the other thing to think about is that cost of capital, you know, and the value of what you're buying. So I mean, we've got if you build a plant in the United States, you've got clear title to it, and access to capital. I mean, you can fund. We do through SBA, the 504 program. We do 25-year loans for real estate and plant for U.S. businesses, and then, like I said, you can also borrow at rates as low as, you know, 5%, which is, I mean, you really got to put pencil to paper and figure out, okay, what are my costs in production in these various places, and what's the value that I place on some of these intangibles.
And Michael, the big takeaway from this, and what Bryson and I are talking about this morning, is that a company can come into SBA or the Commerce Department or the embassy and sit down and spend 5 minutes to several hours, and it won't cost them anything. We're here to help them increase their sales. So they can come in to us, and you can come in with your companies, whatever, and, you know, just sit down and talk to you and try to figure out the best way for you and hold your hand through this process. I will make one caveat, though, as Bryson says, there's a but. In the SBA, ours is on importing. No U.S. government agency will help a company or an individual import products into the United States. So if somebody, one of your listeners, wanted to sell Chinese products into the United States, the U.S. Embassy Commercial Service is not going to help them. They need to contact the Chinese, their embassy. That's what they do here in Washington and throughout the United States. So importing, we are not involved in. But exporting, U.S. products assembled with Chinese good, U.S. manufacturers, yes, we will help them.
Yep, that's fair enough. I think, obviously, the trend has always been selling Chinese products to America, but,
do a pretty good job at that.
Yeah, they're pretty good, so I do agree, and I hope we can help more listeners do it the other way around, and that's what I'm trying to do myself. So I think it's time we Americans sold more products outside rather than took more in. So that's good stuff to talk about. And I'm thinking here, I kind of have some points here. Like, it seems like I know the answer, but I just want to bring it up, is do you have to be a manufacturer or the originator of the goods, or can you be like a trader?
No, yeah, you can be a trader. I mean, I think, you know, one of the things we look at on the SBA side is, you know, the location of the collateral. So, you know, we can't finance goods in a warehouse overseas, but if you've got goods in the United States in a warehouse, you know, that's something that can be financed. If you are shipping them out of the United States, you're creating a receivable that's a legal document that can be used as collateral. So we'll finance outbound shipments.
Okay, that's good to know. And maybe we can give is there a case study or an example of maybe, I know you mentioned Ford, which is a huge company, but maybe someone a little bit smaller that we could, you don't have to maybe disclose their name or their business, but is there somebody who comes to your mind that maybe uses as an example?
Sure. So I work with this company here in Colorado, and they make vitamin supplements for pets. So, you know, these are, you know, little vitamins, and you feed them to your dog or your cat, keeps your dog, cat healthy, keeps their coat looking good. And so they're here in Colorado. They do about 70% of their business in Japan, and they've got one big, big distributor there. And they came to us because the main issue that they were facing was they didn't actually manufacture the product. They had the recipes and the science, and then they contracted out the actual manufacturing to a U.S. company. They had 30-day terms with their contract manufacturer, but they had 60-day terms with their Japanese distributor. So every cycle they got stuck in this cash crunch where they have to pay out the production costs to the manufacturer, but then they're waiting 60 days to get paid from their Japanese distributor. So we were able to set up a line of credit for them with the accounts receivable from the Japanese distributor as the collateral. And we put an insurance policy in place against those accounts receivable. And that's how we were able to help that company grow quite well. And I like that example because the other thing I say is, you think you don't need credit insurance? Has anything bad happened in Japan recently?
Yeah.
Right. So, you know, credit insurance is important. You never know when there's going to be a tidal wave and an earthquake and a nuclear disaster.
True. Yep. And it's only 65 cents on the $100 for the insurance. 100. Yeah.
Yeah. It's amazing, isn't it? I mean, yeah. And then you don't have to worry. You don't have to say, oh, my gosh, what just happened? Did my distributor, one, is everybody alive? And two, where's my money, right?
Yeah.
I'm sure Paul's got some examples of ways that they've helped clients too.
Yeah, there's many different ones. And, you know, I mentioned, you know, we have these programs of finding an agent, a distributor, credit check, trade leads, things like that. But the individual trade specialist, what we find is very rewarding is when a company, a small company especially, or an individual who's representing other companies, presents a problem to us about getting their product or service over there. And then it becomes fun in creating ideas and how to get that over there. Worked with a company for a while selling American native tobacco cigarettes into Asia. And that was taking that from the beginning to the end and competing against the big boys. Another pet product, it's called Kong, K-O-N-G. If anybody has a dog, if they usually, or a cat, some animal, they have this type of product. He approached me about 20-some years ago and wanted to export that, and was in the garage and went through it, helped him find a friend in London, a veterinarian. They introduced the product. Fast forwarded to today, they're in about 40, 50 different countries selling pet products. Pet products are huge international market. Working with companies on the Panama Canal, going against the French, and how we're going to negotiate and win the contract, bringing the U.S. government behind the U.S. companies to make the playing field even. All kinds of example. But that's when it gets fun, when we go off script and really sit down and try to come up with some unique creative ideas how to get that product sold, bring in the contacts like Bryson and I have around the world. As I mentioned, you know, Sarah Kemp in Beijing, or Rogacio in Guangzhou, or Scott Shaw in Hong Kong. Sit down, talk with them, and say, here's my product. How do I sell it?
Okay, that's really great.
Michael, we have a program specially coming up. We call it the Discover Markets Program. And Discover Global Markets. And one starts off in Detroit coming up on free trade agreements, September 9th and 10th. But the one I think your listeners would be interested in, it's called Greater China and Gateway Countries. And it's in New York City, October 7th and 8th. And it's going to feature Beijing, Chengdu, Guangzhou, Hong Kong, Shanghai, Shenyang, Singapore, Taiwan, and Mongolia. how to use these cities and getting your product into that market and what opportunities are over there.
Wow.
If they're interested in that, go to export.gov. They can contact me, contact the embassy. But if somebody's traveling in the United States or is interested in those countries, or not countries, but in those cities and countries, and wanting to meet U.S. companies that are interested into that, New York, October 7th, 8th would be a very good program for them to attend.
Yeah, and New York in October is fabulous.
Yeah, I'm tempted to make that an excuse to get back.
Wow. Yeah, if you can't find anything, you know, contact Bryson and myself, and we'll get you the information. But it's a very good program, and we'll be bringing in people from our people from China, plus our Washington people and other business people that will be talking about doing business in China and those countries.
That sounds really great. I'm writing that in my calendar for sure. So, I mean, that's my main points. I wrote down some of the websites. We'll put them on the website too, on the notes for the show. Do you have any closing marks? And also, I want to get contact information or websites that you are comfortable with sharing for people to continue the conversation.
Sure. I mean, if people want to contact me, my email is Bryson, Bryson, Patterson, Patterson, at sba.gov. Bryson.Patterson at sba.gov.
Great.
Send me an email and we can continue the conversation one-on-one. You know, I would say that, you know, as many of your listeners probably already know, I mean, U.S. products, they could have sort of come with this inherent quality stamp that a lot of people are hungry for. So definitely consider linking up with some U.S. companies to export U.S. goods. And there's a lot of assistance available to do that.
Great, great.
And my contact, Michael, is Paul, P-A-U-L, dot Bergman, B as in boy, E-R-G, M as in Mary, A-N as in Nancy, Paul dot Bergman at trade, T-R-A-D-E, dot gov, G-O-V as in Victor.
Great, great. Thank you guys for sharing. And I really appreciate it. I'm sure our listeners do as well. So,
one final comment, Michael.
Yes, definitely.
When I was a commercial attaché overseas, we found out that a lot of third country nationals were hesitant to come into the U.S. Embassy. Although they were representing U.S. products, they didn't think that because they were French or German or British or Chinese that they could use our services. If a third country person is representing U.S. products, selling U.S. products overseas, the U.S. Embassy will help them. So just because they're Chinese and they're representing U.S. companies, don't hesitate to go in and ask for assistance at the U.S. Embassy.
That's really great. I think I don't know if you see a trend, but there's definitely a trend that Chinese always really like look at American products as quality, and they want to buy more real American products, and there's definitely more interest to import. And so I think I'd like to hear that, and they, that's nice for them to know that they could ask for your help. I don't think that's the same for me as for people buying from Chinese factories. I don't think the Chinese government really helps like that. So it's good to know that you guys are also willing to help non-Americans if they're selling American products even in their own country. So that means like a Chinese person is selling American products in China could get your help. So that's great.
Right. And if they're having trouble with the Chinese to get that license or something.
Yeah. You know, yeah. I mean, actually, I think I need to talk to you guys more because I get a lot of emails and people having trouble with vitamins. It's funny that Bryson brought it up, but there's a lot of people, I guess a lot of supplements in America that are made that are seem to have trouble getting classified into customs HTC codes in China to get, seems a little bit difficult. And,
yeah, absolutely. That's something that the Department of Commerce can assist with.
And at the embassy and at the UCACs, most all of us, especially the embassies too, but here in Denver, we have our trade specialists divided up by industry sectors. So when you talk about medical products, vitamins, supplements, we have one person that stays up and follows all those rules and regulations worldwide. And we have other people on aerospace or sporting goods or software. So we feel that it's important for that senior trade specialist to have that knowledge and expertise to work through those types of problems with those companies.
Great, great. No, this is really great. So thanks so much, guys.
Thanks a lot, Mike. Appreciate you hosting us. And look forward to hopefully working with you and some of your listeners in the future.
Yeah, I'm sure there's going to be a lot of chances. So thanks so much.
Thank you, Michael.
I'm so thankful for Bryson and Paul to share on the show. It's an interesting story how we got connected, actually. I was living in San Diego back in 2007, and I met Ben Garfunkel, who was working in the Export Bank at the time. And while I've been doing this podcast, I've, of course, listened to people's feedback, and Chris Gormley mentioned that I should have an episode about export financing from America. So I reached out to Ben. After a few years, I've not been in touch with him. He hasn't worked in this industry for a while, but he connected me up with Bryson, and that's how we got the show. So it's, talk about a long stretch, but it's really fun, and happy to get this show into the series of the Global from Asia. I hope people learned and can take action from it. It's also not just for Americans, as they said, it's for anybody that's selling American goods anywhere in the world. They're more than happy to help you, so I hope you guys take them up on it. Okay, and next week we're going to have Fionn back on the show for a second part of that two-part series. I know I put a couple shows in between. It's going to be talking about audits and bookkeeping for a Hong Kong company. This one I'm asked all the time, and I've said from the beginning of the show, Gerard, who's on the Mastermind, also is learning about that, and he's curious for this. So I hope you guys listen and learn and give me more feedback. Thanks again for listening, and see you next week. Bye-bye.
To get more info about running an international business via Hong Kong, please visit our website at www.globalfromasia.com. That's www.globalfromasia.com. Also, be sure to subscribe to our iTunes feed. Thanks for tuning in.